Happy Friday, everyone. We made it. Yes, we made it from the first week back from winter break. And it was really great to see all of you. I told you yesterday that I wasn't going to be able to make it today, but don't worry because I'm going to be in the building grading away so that your grades are updated by Monday. So take a look on Monday to see what your accurate grade is so you know exactly what you need to do in order to prepare for finals. Because remember, we are going to have a finals test for the first semester. I want to tell you really quickly before I forget about a wonderful opportunity that's going to be provided for ninth graders. On Wednesday, January 12th, which is our early release, there is going to be a study and snack section put on by yours truly and Link Crew leaders. Now, this is going to be an opportunity for you to go to a specific subject and learn some really valuable study skills that you'll be able to apply to your other subjects and for your future subsequent years in education. This is going to be a wonderful opportunity. And if you can't make it on Wednesday, don't you worry because there is a second opportunity on Friday, February 21st. The one on the 12th, Wednesday, is going to be from 12:30 until 2:30. And the one on the 21st, which is a Friday, is from 3 to 4:30. You will need to provide your own rides home. If that's going to be a concern, let me know and I can help you figure it out. Now, back to our lesson today. You are going to be able to follow this video at your own pace, which means if there is a set of directions that you didn't quite understand, you have the freedom to pause and rewind so you can hear the instructions again. But we're going to start off by answering our last day of the week's warm-up question. So the question is, why are we using pigeons to learn about Junko's genetics? Why and how is this possible? And what do they share in common? So this really has to do with the very end of yesterday's lesson where we were talking about the chromosomes. And I mentioned about how there's this such thing as a model organism. And if I didn't mention it before, I'm definitely mentioning it now. The model organism is something that we use that is really similar to the organism of study. And if there isn't a lot of research already done, we can look at other organisms to make a prediction of how we think our research organism is going to behave. For example, we use mice a lot in our laboratories and research when we're trying to develop different medications and to see the reaction that a mouse would have. Because believe it or not, humans and mice have a lot more in common than you might have thought. So we can use that information from mice and how they react and make predictions of how that would affect our human body. So in this case, we don't have a lot of research about Junkos already done, right? But we do have research about pigeons. So I'd like you to go ahead, pause this video for just a second while you answer your warm-up in your warm-up slides. So go ahead, pause. And I'll come back to me when you're ready. All right, so you're ready to go on to the next section. So let's do a little bit of rewind, right? Let's take a look and make sure that we know what we're supposed to be doing since yesterday. At the end of yesterday's lesson, we spent some time learning about how you inherit the chromosomes and how many from each partner. At the very beginning of lesson 17, there were two questions that you were supposed to make a prediction about, trying to understand what is physically being passed down from generation to generation and why it's possible that if you have a sibling from the same biological parent, why it's possible for you to look different from each other. And now, after learning a little bit more about some key vocabulary words like chromosomes and genes and DNA and alleles, and we learned about proteins, we learned all this rich vocabulary, and we learned how they come together, right? Remember that we use that in sexual reproduction, we need to have two partners where they have half of the chromosomes come from one parent. And the other half come from another. During sexual reproduction, there are gamete cells. These are key vocabulary words you're going to want to be using in your answer, so listen carefully. There are gamete cells. Gamete cells are specific cells that are used for sexual reproduction. In the female, gamete cells are eggs. They're the ones that come from your ovaries. And in the males, that's sperm. So when the sperm and the egg meet, they create a zygote. And that is when you got the 23 chromosomes from the male and 23 chromosomes from the female to combine and create a zygote, a full cell with 46 chromosomes, which is how many we need in order for proper development. Now, we talked a lot about that, and then we saw and learned a little bit more about how many chromosomes there are in juncos and in pigeons. So before we move on to the rest of it, I want to remind you that you should have answers 4, 5, and 6 completed. These were review questions. These were the ones where we're taking all of that information where we just learned and we're summarizing and creating an explanation. And this is very important, that is in our own words, right? So remember, it's so important for you guys to answer these questions with as many details and as much specifics as you can, because that's how you really show somebody what you understand and how well you understand. Don't forget, this assignment is graded. So you should be having 3 to 5 sentences for each one of your answers. If for some reason, and you shouldn't because there's plenty to talk about, but if for some reason you're having a difficult time reaching that amount of sentences, think about adding the phrase, for example, and follow that with an example and explain it. That is one of the best ways that you can demonstrate your understanding, is providing an example, but not just stating it, also having to explain it. And that's going to help you reach around that 5-sentence range. Which, if you remember how I repeated this a lot, next semester, my expectation goes from 3 to 5 sentences to 5 to 7 sentences. So if you haven't had a chance to answer questions 4, 5, and 6, now's a great time for you to pause this video. Otherwise, you can just continue on. So if you've already answered 4, 5, and 6, we have also had a chance to create this model, okay? So this is one of the last things of the day of yesterday, if I got to it. If I didn't get to it, you're in luck. So this is the type of model framework that we're going to fill out towards the end for our conclusions. So if we take a look at what this is telling us, it's saying which alleles of which genes provide the instructions to cells on what substances they produce. That's pretty wordy. All it's saying is what genes is going to lead to what traits. It's really what they're trying to understand. So they're trying to tell us what alleles, and you have the definition below. Remember that an allele is a variant form of a gene. So if gene is hair color, right? You can have brown hair, you can have blonde hair, you can have red hair, you can have sandy blonde hair. All of those are going to be, are all variants or variations of hair color. Hair color would be what, there is a specific gene name for it, but the alleles are those types of hair, right? So really making sure we remember what alleles are. So in this space, and again, you're going to see this in the conclusion section of your paper, in this part, what we're trying to figure out is which alleles, okay, are responsible for and lead to which traits. So what alleles are going to lead to what we see, right? So that's what I would like for you to have typed into your paper. I know that in lesson 17, there's an area for you to go ahead and type this in if you haven't already. You can go ahead and pause, unless you've already done it, in which case we'll continue. So now you're at the part where we are going to actually take a look at the genes of pigeons. Now, if you remember, the question that we're trying to answer for lesson 17 is, how are physical traits like wing color or wing length inherited? We've talked about the general framework and process of how genes and those genes that are on the chromosomes get passed down to their offspring. Remember that offspring are just the children or the babies from the parents. So now we're going to take a deep dive look into the world of pigeons. Remember, we don't have that much information about juncos yet. So we're really going to use this information that's already been documented about pigeons and apply that information to juncos. That's what we call that model organism, bringing that word back. So to do this, we're going to be focusing on, let me get to the proper page. This is that section I was just telling you about. That you're going to type that information. So now you're over and ready for this part. So you've got your pigeon activity, and this is going to be a jigsaw. You can choose to work on this individually, or you can divvy this up with your table groups and share out at the end of class. There are two options. You can either do this digitally or on paper. The paper version is already in the front of the room. There's a bunch of piles, so just do your best to choose the one that looks just like this. If you click this button, it's going to prompt you to make your own copy. So you're going to make a copy of it. And once you do, one second, there I am. And once you do, you can go ahead and get started. So basically, if you take a look at this data table, it's going to be a place for you to go ahead and take notes. So if you take a look at the left side, they talk about the traits. So each row is going to be a different trait that pigeons have. So we're going to do the crest together. And to take a look ahead, you've got foot feathering, wing pattern, color. And then we also have spread, recessive red, and dilute. Now, if you've never heard of those traits before, don't worry. In the website, they'll kind of give you a brief definition or explanation of what each one is. A couple of things to note before you click on the website, the physical characteristics or phenotypes, right? Remember, that's those features that we see. So even though I have a mixed genotype, so I've got the brown hair, the dominant hair from my mom, and the blonde hair from my dad, I have the big B and the little B. Even though I have a little bit of both, my hair shows up brown, ignoring the hair coloring, but I do have brown hair, dark brown hair. Now, the gene name, which is going to be important because that is something that's going to have to be answered, the gene name is going to be in red and italicized. So that means that the crest is going to have, this is the name of the gene that is going to that is going to be responsible for the crest. And the crest is going to be the way that the top of the head is shaped. And you'll see that in a moment. Allele names are in single quotes, meaning, like, for example, either you have a crest or you don't have a crest. Those are the two options. Those are the two alleles or the two variations that exist for crest. And the protein name that is produced will be in all caps. So taking a look at our table, we can already go ahead and answer some of the beginning. So how would you describe what different variations of this trait look like? So to find out that information, you're going to come to this link and you are going to click on it. Now, if you've chosen the written version, you're going to type this in. Go ahead and click allow so that you can get access. Now, the other thing that you're going to click is pigenetics. So that's going to be that very first option on the left side. So you'll go ahead and you will click on this. I think I may have. This is awkward. Oh my God, I hope that this is...
You've probably seen this guy before. Maybe up on a wire or flying. It's a pigeon. Or more... Domestic rock pit people like to breed pigeons with the first thing you need to know sex is determined by your first puzzle.
Okay, so this is really fun and I highly recommend you do it, but that's not what I meant. It's actually all right here, so take that back. So when we're looking for the information, it tells you all the traits on the right side. Don't click on the left side. But on the right side, you're going to see all of those traits that were on your in your table. So we're going to start with crest, and we're going to do this one together. So the first thing that we need to do is first describe what this trait could look like. So if we take a look, we've had the wild type, which typically means that this is the one with no crest. And so that you can see has kind of a flat kind of curvature on their head. Meanwhile, if they have a crest, you're going to see this little bump that's kind of at the top of the head, kind of like my ponytail. Ironic. So that's kind of the crest that is going to be there. So you're going to kind of use your own words, not kind of, you're going to use your own words to fill out that table. So if you go back to your table that you've created here, you're going to describe what the different variations on the trait look like. So you can say that the no crest has a smooth head, while a crest has a bump on the back of their head, like Miss Fierstein's ponytail. Just kidding, you don't have to write that, but I'm leaving it. Okay, so now the next question is the number of genes that influence this trait. So we've been talking a lot about how there are some that we talk about, like, oh, here's the hair color gene and here's the eye color gene. But in actuality, there's a lot of genes that can play into a trait that we see. So we're going to want to go ahead and read throughout the information. Sometimes they're going to be really, really simple and straightforward, and sometimes you're going to have to infer. Luckily for us, in the very first sentence, it tells us there is one gene that controls the presence or absence of a crest. So we don't have to do a lot of digging, but it's not always going to be that easy. So please be mindful. But when we come back to our table, when we do the number of genes that influence this trait, we can write down one because it told us that in the information. There's only one gene that's going to code for it. Question three is the number or kind of different alleles that influence this trait. So if we go back to our website, we can read the rest of this. This gene comes in two different versions of our alleles. Amazing, it's right there for us. So we can put in our table that one of the options is crest or no crest. And they also tell you that the no crest is also considered the wild type. So if we go back to our table, we can say that there are two types. If I could type. There are two types, the crest and no crest. Now we know what our options are. What's the possibility that could be passed on to our next generations? Number four is saying, how do the alleles affect the substances that cell produce? So remember that these genes are telling the cell what to create. Those are the instructions, the blueprint, the manual to explain to that particular cell what it is that they need to do to create it. So the alleles are going to give a little bit of different directions. So let's take a look together. So it says the pigeon inherits two copies of the crest gene, one from each parent. Two alleles together make up a genotype. What we see makes a phenotype. So this is kind of giving us that background information. So now here's going to give us some DNA to protein, finding the gene for the crest. So we're really just going to go ahead and kind of skim it. You don't have to necessarily read everything, but skimming it is also a skill. So if you're not comfortable or don't know how to skim well, then I'd recommend that you read it all so you can find the answer. So it says, ultimately, the differences in our ant pigeons' inherited characteristics arise from differences in the DNA sequences of our genes. DNA differences can affect how a protein functions or when or and where a protein is made. In 2013, a group of researchers at the University of Utah, led by Professor Mike Shapiro, identified the genetic variation that causes the CREST phenotype. To find the CREST gene, the research team looked at the genomes, genomes just meaning the total genes that they know exist, of 42 pigeons representing 372 breeds, blah, 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 blah. They compared the DNA sequences and they found a region of DNA that was different between crested and non-crested birds. The region contained one gene called the EPHB2, short for efferent receptor 2. So B2. So remember that the genes actually have specific names. So if we were to skim here, we know they're talking a little bit more about the sample size and how they were able to identify the versions or the alleles of this gene. And then in the last paragraph, it says groups of three nucleotides. Now we haven't learned what nucleotides are, but they're basically the chemicals that make up the blueprint. So like the different order of chemicals are what gives the instructions and how it's read. So just keep that in mind. That's not important at this moment. We'll get to that later on. The most important thing is to keep reading on because it's going to tell you what and how it's going to be affected. So it says groups of three nucleotides along a stretch of DNA code for specific amino acids in a protein. Amino acids are the things that build up the protein. The protein coding portions of the CREST and no CREST alleles differ by just one nucleotide, and they code for proteins that differ by just one amino acid. So now that we understand how they differ, it seems like this next part is going to explain how it is affected. So the CREST phenotype is visibly very early while a chick is still developing inside the egg. As soon as neck and head feathers appear, they start to grow backwards. Instead of pointing down toward the tail, the feathers point upward toward the top of the head. The EPHB2 protein appears to have something to do with setting up feather orientation even earlier in development. The no CREST allele codes for a protein that functions normally. It sits in the cell membrane, and when a certain signal from outside the cell attaches to it, it transmits a signal to the inside of the cell. The CREST allele codes for a protein that is broken. The one amino acid difference changes the shape of the protein, making it unable to transmit the signal. And that, my friend, is the answer to number 4. So basically, when you have the CREST allele, it's blocking a signal to the development, which means that the feathers no longer are going to grow down towards the tail. It's going to grow upwards, right? And because we know that what is the number and or kind of different variations that this can result in, this can only result in two things. You're going to notice that in other traits, it's possible for there to be a third or fourth option, depending on how many alleles there are. That's something later that we will discuss, but that is not always going to be the same answer. In our case, it is, but that's something that you need to read carefully. So I'd like for you to pause this video now and either decide to do this individually, or you can talk with your table groups and see if you want to share the workload. But you're going to spend the rest of the time figuring out the information for each one of these traits. So go ahead, pause the video, and then come back when you're done. All right, welcome back. So now that you've had a chance to take a look at different juncos, or excuse me, different traits of pigeons, I want you to go ahead and explain. So go to that conclusion portion on your document. So if you take a look here, you just were here. So now remember that model, we're going to go ahead and take our information and answer our two questions. How can we use what we figured out to explain why juncos have different amounts of white in their tail feathers and how can we use what we figured out to explain why juncos have different wing lengths. So these are the opportunities for you to use this model. This gene leads to these alleles, which leads to these outcomes. So you should have plenty of information. Do your best, pause the video, and come back when you are ready to see how close you are. Okay. Welcome back. We are almost done, you guys. So taking a look at your information, you're going to check what you thought your answer was with the one that I'm about to share you with you. So if we take a look at how can we use what we figured out to help us explain why juncos have different amounts of white in their tail feathers, your model should be something like this. There are chromosomes with different alleles that a junco can inherit from its parents. That leads to different substances like pigments or melanin, both of which you should know, being produced by cells or not. Maybe they're being produced, maybe not. Then that leads to many different variations of feather color, shape, and pattern. Okay, so that's the ultimate outcome. And then that same is accurate for 8 as well. So how can we use what we figured out to help us explain why juncos have different wing lengths? There are chromosomes with different alleles that a junco can inherit from its parents. Different substances like hormones, right, being produced by cells or not. And that leads to many different variations of body limb sizes and body limb proportions. So that's what you should have. And then the last thing that you should do before you turn this in is think about the next steps. We spent a lot of time this week talking about how these physical traits are inherited. So the next thing we need to learn is about how the boldness is different. Remember, our whole thing is trying to understand how juncos from the mountain differ from juncos in San Diego. In lesson 16, we identified that there are some different traits between these two. We talked about the physical traits today, and so now we're going to talk about how, why, and how the birds in Mount Laguna are less bold than the juncos in San Diego. So I want you to think about how can a scientist make these measurements? How do we measure boldness in birds? So answer this question, come up with your own. If you were to research this, what steps would you do? What would your procedure look like? And what would you measure? Once you've done that, you're all done with lesson 17 and you're ready to turn it in. Have a wonderful weekend and I'll see you on Monday. How do I stop this? Okay, got it. Bye.